covering the High Plains with news, weather, and information. From TV 23 Studios in Sublette, this is High Plains Today.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to this special edition of High Plains Today. I am joined in studio by, he is the representative from the 125th District of the Kansas State House of Representatives, Shannon Francis.
How hey, are Chris. You today? Great, great.
Good to see ya.
It's cold out there.
I know it's cold, but next week it's going to heat up, literally,
that's
as
right.
well as you get started. You guys get started back in Topeka on Monday, right?
That's right, 2 o'clock. We get sworn in.
Okay, so sworn in, re-sworn in, et cetera, et cetera.
Yes.
Okay. So Monday, and then you have a few technicalities that you work out on Monday also?
Yeah, technically we have to elect the Speaker of the House and the Speaker pro tem, even though the Republican caucus, which is the majority party in the House, have already made those selections. We have to go through that formality.
So does the whole entire House vote on that?
Yes, the entire House votes on it. But
you don't see any surprises.
Every time in the past, the nominee from the ruling party or the majority party has selected the Speaker and the Speaker pro tem.
All right, so nothing big going on there. All
and
right.
You know, we have a person with local roots as the Speaker of the House candidate.
That's
Ron
true.
Reichman Jr.
Yes.
grew up in Meade.
In fact, I think his folks still live in Meade, don't they, Ron
yes.
Reichman Sr.?
Yes, his father was the representative from Meade last session.
Yeah, and he just retired. He's an old school teacher.
He is.
Right?
He is.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so then on Tuesday, you get to hear the governor, state of the state, right?
That's 5 right.
o'clock, Tuesday afternoon.
That's right.
Be there, be square.
And by the way, you can pick it up, you can live stream it from Kansas.gov.
Yeah.
I don't know what the exact
web address is. Yeah, we'll find that. We'll put that on our website. But what do you expect him to, is he going to lay out anything in particular in his state of the state? Or is he going to get up there? I'm sure he's not going to say the sun's still shining in Kansas, is he?
He may say that the sun's still shining. The first week, we hope that we get the governor's budget proposal. He's talked about having a solution for the budget crisis that we're facing. We're approximately $342 million deficit by the end of June. That's what the forecast is right now. Supposedly, he's got a solution to that requires no bad cuts, no bad tax increases, and no bad layoffs. I hope he does,
right.
but I
well,
can't
okay,
find
so
my way through
that. Let's talk about that for a quick second, because, you know, the latest, we got a new guy doing the estimates, right, for the state,
well,
the new revenues.
Three people in the revenue department have retired within the last 45 days.
All right. Well, I think the Senate has to confirm him. I can't remember his name right off the hand.
Right. It's from Wichita, I believe.
He came in, $6 million to the plus for December. So that brings it down
right.
to the $342 million by June 30th.
Right.
So you think the governor is going to propose some cuts? Where's he going to cut?
Well, he says that we're not going to take any money from education, I believe. I really don't see it. There's a couple of games we can still play. We cannot make the last two or three of our CAPERS payments, where we're matching what's withheld from the teachers and the state employees' salaries. Investment fund.
I was going to say, there's an investment fund that is left over that he hopes to, but that's another one-time fix, right?
Yeah, that's another one-time fix. And I think the majority of the legislature, we want a long-term solution. We've got a structural deficit, and we understand that we're going to have to do some one-time fixes until the revenue flows in, but we're tired of one-time fixes.
We've been doing a lot of one-time fixes.
Been doing one-time fixes as long as I've been up there.
You've been up there for, this will be your third year up there, and for 2 years you've been doing, I know, you always famously tell me, all we do is just kick the can down the road, we got to quit doing that.
And, you know, people at home say, well, let's cut spending. And we have cut spending. We have slashed the T-Works highway plan. We have cut spending at the colleges. We've cut spending at Medicaid. And one of the things people don't understand is one of the largest drivers of our Medicaid costs are our seniors that are in nursing homes. And when we cut Medicaid spending, we don't really do away with any of the services that we're covering. We cut the reimbursements to the nursing homes, to our rural hospitals, to our rural doctors, and our urban doctors also. I mean, everybody gets cut if they handle Medicaid patients. But again, don't forget that a lot of our Medicaid patients are seniors that have run out of money, that are living in a nursing home. It's not what a lot of people think.
It hits pretty hard.
We've done some other things where we've increased sales tax. So when we say we haven't increased taxes, we've increased sales tax. We've done away with deductions. Like one of the deductions, again, that's really hard on our senior citizens is we did away with the deduction for your health care expenses. You know, you and I, when we get sick, we get an antibiotic and we're usually good and we move on down the road. But our seniors, when they're in a nursing home, that's an allowable health care expense. They've lost that deduction on their income tax.
That's got to hit hard.
It does.
All right. We're going to take a quick break. But when we come back, I want to delve more into the budget. And, you know, we're going to talk about the elephant in the room of what's going to happen with education and those types of things, because it's coming, right?
It's coming.
All right. That's going to be a big one. All right. Stay right there. Shannon and I'll be back right after this.
You're watching High Plains Today on TV 23 with host Chris Jewell. TV23's internet service and 4G live streaming provided by United Wireless. Coverage you deserve. Service you expect. United Wireless.
Hi, Chris Jewell, host of High Plains Today, a 30-minute news and information program that airs weekdays at noon right here on TV23. We talk about news, we talk about sports, we talk about weather, we're even going to talk entertainment. We'll have live guests right here on set with me. So, every day at noon, tune in. High Plains Today. We'll see you then.
Weekdays here on TV23.
And welcome back to this special edition of High Plains Today. I'm joined by Shannon Francis. He is the representative for the 125th District to the Kansas House of Representatives. And they get started next week. Boom. It's going to warm up. We were talking about, you know, next week, get started, governor, state of the state, and then you guys are going to have to plow right into it right away, right? I mean, because we talked earlier about $342 million deficit that's got to be taken care of by June 30th.
Yes.
Because July 1, new year, a whole different ball of game.
And that's spending that's got to be cut this year.
All right. We've talked about a few places that the money's going to come from. Like there's an investment fund out there, but I mean,
and my understanding of that investment fund, I don't. For those of you that follow this pretty closely, this is kind of a geeky thing, but you know, 45 days ago we were talking about taking unclaimed property from the treasurer's office. Well, the treasurer said you really can't do that for a number of reasons. My understanding is this investment fund that we're talking about is where the unclaimed property goes until it's claimed. So they kind of just changed the name. My understanding also is that historically we've moved about $40 million a year from this unclaimed property tax to the general fund anyway. So if we use that money, it's just going to be another IOU because there are claims that can be used that can be charged against this.
It's a one-time sweep again, right?
That's right. And we're hurting our cash flow in the years down the road by approximately $40 million a year. I haven't had that confirmed, but that's what someone in Topeka told me last week.
All right. So let's look at this. I mean, the $342 million. Then we're going to go into next year.
Right.
And you guys are going to start working on the budget for the following 2 years, right?
Right. And the forecast shortage for that is over $500 million.
Yeah. All right. So what, I mean, are we going to approach the LLCs and that tax cut and get back to, you know, the tax cuts of 2012, 2013, when all that took effect, when the governor first came to office?
I don't think there's an appetite in the legislature to totally reverse the 2012 tax cuts. One, because we have increased taxes in other areas since. So totally repealing that would be overkill. We'd create problems in other areas. But I do hear that there is an appetite for restoring taxes on LLCs, subchapter S's. We call it the LLC fix, and I want everybody to understand it's really not that. Basically, every business in the state of Kansas is exempted from state tax except for C corporations. They got left out. So you can have two businesses that do the exact same thing. One's a C corp, one's an S corp. The S corp pays no state tax. The C corp still pays state tax. So there's a question of fairness also.
Well, yeah, because if you were a C corp and you reorganized as an S corp, boom, no taxes, right?
Yeah. Some of the other issues that come into this that we don't factor in, and I think the failure of this policy has to do with economics. Kansas is not a closed system, like not nearly as much of a closed system as the U.S. government is. But let's use an example of I have a S corp that has a commercial property in Liberal, Kansas. I have two partners. One of my partners lives in Kansas like I do. One of my partners lives in Oklahoma City. He's not paying any Kansas taxes.
None. Okay. None.
He's not necessarily going to spend any of that tax savings in Kansas. He's not necessarily going to reinvest any of that tax money in Kansas. He's looking for the highest return on his investment, wherever that might be. And I think sometimes we lose track of the fact that growth an economy is based upon demand, and we need to be doing things to increase demand in Kansas, that kind of growth. It's not going to happen just because we cut taxes.
Well, yeah, because the latest figures that have come out, you know, say that, yeah, people are moving to Kansas, but there's also more people moving out than coming in. So we're at a deficit there, too.
To go back to the analogy of the Oklahoma partner in a business, what also happens is most states give you a credit for taxes that you pay out of state. So, for instance, I've got a brother that lives in Minnesota, and we have farm ground out here. So he's not paying Kansas tax. When he gets that money in Minnesota, he doesn't have the credit for the Kansas tax to pay, so he's paying his taxes in Minnesota also.
Aha. So he's still paying, yeah, okay, he's still paying taxes.
And I think it was just a question in 2012. People wanted to do the right thing, but they really didn't understand the tax system. You know, we let our wishes get ahead of reality.
You know, well, and the governor has also said, one thing that he said, you know, lately and coming into this latest session is that, you know, it's ill-advised and poorly timed if we're going to start looking at, you know, putting the LLCs back into the tax roll. He's not, you know, he's not in favor of it, right?
You know, we'll just have to see what happens. The fact of the matter is we've got a $342 million deficit this year. Even if we restore the LLC fix.
It's about a $250 million advantage, right?
Yeah, some people want it to be 300. Some people think it's 200. We don't know exactly what it
is. So we'll call it 250.
Yeah. That doesn't plug the hole. You know, the other part of that hole that was created was we did away with the top income tax rate in Kansas, and it was 6.4, I believe. And currently, the top income tax rate in Kansas is 4.6. So that creates some of the rest of that hole, and we just need to adjust that. Real quickly, again, I just want everybody to understand that even if you're not directly affected by this, people you love and care for are affected by this. You know, we did away with 30% of the funding, I believe, for the Senior Home Care Act. And one of the things that Senior Home Care Act did was it allowed seniors to stay in their homes longer rather than have to move to a nursing home,
anything like that, right? So,
you know, there's some things that we're doing out here other than just our roads, other than some of our schools that are affecting things.
All right, speaking of schools, stay right there. We're going to take a quick break. We come back. That's the other big elephant in the room.
Yeah.
Because the Supreme Court could come out any day and say, uh-oh.
Yeah.
Stick around. Shannon and I will be back right after. Hi, I'm Chris Jewell, host of High Plains Today, a 30-minute news and information program that airs at noon weekdays right here on TV 23. Hey, do you think you have an idea for something that would make a great segment? Somebody that would make a great interview? What about a community event that needs highlighting? Let us know here at the station. Email us, news@kbgltv.com. And welcome back to this special edition of High Plains Today. Today we're talking with Shannon Francis. He is the representative of the Kansas House, District 125. All right, we've talked about the governor. We've talked about the budget hole that's coming up. There's two other big elephants in the room. One of them is education.
Yep.
Anytime the Supreme Court could throw a wing doodle in the middle of this whole deal and say, sorry, state of Kansas, you need to put about $500 million back into the budget for education. Then what happens?
Well, and that just goes back to we need a long-term revenue fix. You know, we've got to cure this structural deficit. Part of what you're bringing up is we don't know what the gap is until we get that Supreme Court ruling. You know, 2 years ago, we passed something called the block grant. Since that time, we've pretty well frozen the amount of money that we've allocated for schools, and we've gave every school district about the same amount of money as they got the year before. If you're a district with declining enrollment, that works out really, really good, because the old formula was based upon the number of students and then certain compensating factors. If you were a growing school district, it created some issues.
It hit you pretty hard.
It did hit you pretty hard.
All right, so if the Supreme Court comes out and says, you know, no, state of Kansas, you're underfunding. And now, and here's the other thing. The legislature has had, 2 years to work on a new formula, because that's why the governor came up with the block grants, is because they said this old formula was outdated, nobody could understand it, et cetera, et cetera. So we went to the block grants. But so far, I don't think they've done anything on a new formula, have they?
No, it's been pretty hard to develop a consensus on what changes needed to be made to the old formula. There were some things wrong with the old formula. You know, there's always a way to improve things. And I think that the solutions in government, we need to look at them like you would in a business. And for instance, you know,
that's the problem. They don't, though.
This is an iPhone 6 Plus.
Yeah, you had the big one.
It's nothing like the iPhone 1 was.
Sure.
You know? And we've had incremental change, we've had incremental improvements, and that was the failure of the block grant, was rather than make it incremental changes and improvements, I think they wanted to start from scratch. Well, for instance, there was a portion of the old funding formula that was called the second count. The second count was initiated for where the military bases are, because what happens if you're in Junction City or Leavenworth is the military can make huge changes in student populations in those areas based upon...
Yeah, it's because you had your count September 20th, and then in the spring, you had another count to take that into effect. If you gain students, here's some more money.
And that was one of the complications. And what would happen on the state level was we would allocate so much money for education, then the second count would come in, and our caseloads would go up. There were solutions to that, like maybe basing... no change for your reimbursements unless your student body changed by a certain percentage. I mean, there were solutions to these things.
Yeah.
But it's not simple to allocate adequately funds with the formula, with the same formula for the kids in Tribune versus the kids in Johnson County.
I mean, or the kids in
Liberal.
Olathe versus Dodge City, Garden City, Blue Valley. I mean, it's all different. All right, so... hopefully they'll get to work on that.
They are, and they've got a great chairman. They selected Clay Arend, who he's going to look like a freshman to people that haven't followed this. But he laid out for, I believe, 6 years. At one time, he was majority leader in the House, and he was chair of education forever. He's from up in north central Kansas, and I think he'll represent rural interests well.
Okay. We got a couple of minutes left. Now, you have been appointed your vice chairman of the House Transportation Committee.
Yes.
Let's talk a little bit about transportation and the Bank of KDOT, because, I mean, that's one place there's not going to be any more cuts, right?
There can't be. You know, I believe
I don't know where it's going to come from, right?
And KDOT is constitutionally protected because it's fuel tax.
Okay. So, because, you know, out here in Southwest Kansas, you know, we've had a lot of projects that have been scaled way back or cut.
Yes.
You know, I mean, you know, the US 54 project down east of Liberal was supposed to be 10 to 11 miles. It's now down to 3 miles.
Right.
There was a project to put US 50 from Cimarron to Dodge City, make it 4-lane, and that just went away.
Right.
So, I mean, where does KDOT go from here, and what does the state do, I mean, with transportation?
Well, again, I think it goes back to we need this long-term structural fix for this deficit. It's going to be compromised. I think T-Works, as it was originally conceived, is gone. I think that we have to try to find a way to get some funding back into KDOT. I don't think it's going to be to the level that it was. I just don't think that'll come out of the compromises that's going to happen this year. It's just going to be difficult. We don't have any money. Again, when people say you need to cut spending, well, we've cut spending $500 million on highways, and that's not where most of us in rural Kansas wanted it to be cut.
Yeah, you say, I mean, we've cut transportation, you know, KDOT $500 million, but we're still, you know, $242 million behind, or $342. Sorry,
right.
I was giving them the benefit of the doubt there. So
well, and you know, the economy is a moving ball. It moves all the time. You know, we have had some economic shocks to rural Kansas with oil and gas, ag. Those things aren't helping any at all.
Right.
They're not the underlying cause of the problem that we're going through, but they still don't help anything at all. You know, I wish I could tell you we're going to go up and we're going to wave the magic wand and we're going to restore the KDOT funding. I think we're going to be able to restore a portion of it. But we need to find a long-term, we need to come together with a long-term solution for this funding crisis and move forward.
That's going to be the biggie this session, isn't it?
It is.
Come up with something big.
That's the big deal.
I don't envy you at all. Keep me posted. I know you will.
I am optimistic, though. You know, there were changes in the last election. I think the people in the legislature now, they realize we have a problem. They realize that we're going to have to take some tough votes.
Senate and House leadership are kind of coming around and seeing what's going on now, right?
That's right. So there is hope.
That's good.
2 years ago, I didn't have any hope. It was just like, oh, just give it time. This is going to work. You know, we've gave it another 2 years. It's getting worse. It's not getting better.
All right. Keep me posted.
Okay.
I'll drag you back up here when you get a break later in a few months. All right.
Okay.
Shannon, as always, thanks for coming by. And thanks for joining us on this special edition of High Plains Today. See you next time.
Keep up to date with the latest information from TV 23 on our Facebook page, KDGL TV.